This video will instruct you on how to perform a modified version of the dialysis experiment, similar to the one that was conducted in the Lab 5 video. So this one you get to do at home using some of the pieces in your new physiology kit. So the first thing to do is to open up that big brown paper bag and start pulling out all of the components in that kit and laying them out so you can kind of identify what's what. And then I'll tell you what you need to separate. So you're going to need to pull out the plastic bag that says dialysis on it. You'll also need a test tube that says dialysis. Now there's two test tubes in there. Make sure you get the one that says dialysis or dialysis powder. You're going to need the graduated cylinder and a 50 milliliter beaker. Now you can use one of the absorbent pads if you like here, but it's not necessary since we're not working with hazardous materials. You'll need some additional items that are probably in your house somewhere. Find a shallow bowl, like a cereal bowl, and fill it most of the way up with water. And then also find a pair of scissors, so you're going to need those to go ahead and get started. Feel free to pause the video as needed until you have the required items. The first thing to do is to soak our dialysis tubing. The tubing actually doesn't look like tubing when we first get it. It's dry and it looks like ribbon. But you're going to go ahead and find this in your plastic bag labeled dialysis, and you're going to cut off about a 6 to 8 inch strip, and then you're going to soak it in a bowl of tap water, and you're going to let it sit there for about 15 minutes. While the dialysis tubing is soaking, let's work on dissolving the dialysis powder in 10 milliliters of solution. It's a 10 milliliter test tube, so we're just going to go ahead and add water to close to the top of the test tube. And once I do that, I'm going to go ahead and cap it. Make sure you've got a good handle on it so you don't spill it. Cap it thoroughly, and then I'm going to shake it up. And what I found is that that actually doesn't do a very good job dissolving the powder. So we're going to employ some tricks to help us out. The first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to use the plastic pipette that comes with the kit and kind of squeeze it to create some motion in there and hope that I can kind of suck up some of the powder and get it to mix. That helps a little bit, but it doesn't help enough. So what we really need is some heat, because dissolving the stuff is an endergonic reaction. So to provide some heat, what I'm gonna do is get a coffee cup, fill it with some water, put it in the microwave for a minute and a half, like I would for a cup of coffee. And then I'm gonna go ahead and add my test tube to my now warm cup of coffee or cup of water, and I'm going to let the solution get warm. So basically it took about 5 minutes of me putting this test tube in here to get some good dissolution. Now mechanical agitation helped some more, so I still had kind of a chunk at the bottom that was having some difficulty dissolving, so I went back to my little pipette and mechanically agitated it until it dissolved. And again, the entire process probably took about 5 minutes. All right, so you are done when the solution no longer has chunks in it and it looks pretty cloudy as shown. So now we're gonna go ahead and return to our dialysis tubing, which has been soaking for about 15 minutes. And I cut an 8 inch strip off, but I really only need about 6 inches. So I'm just gonna cut a little bit more off here. You can keep 8 inches if you'd like to start with. You'll be cutting it down later anyway. And then what we're going to do is we are going to take our fingers and basically roll the tubing, one end of the tubing, in between our fingers over and over and over again until eventually the tube separates. So it takes me a little bit of time anyway. Some people are faster. But once it separates, you can kind of see right there the opening of the tube. So once you have one end separated like that, keep rolling the tubing in between your fingers and get good separation all the way down the length of the dialysis tubing so that both the top and the bottom have good openings to them. Now it's time to tie off one end of the dialysis tubing. So if this rectangle were to represent the length of my dialysis tubing, then the arrow represents approximately where you want to tie off the end. So it's a little hard to see here, but I'm first going to cut down my string so that I have a smaller amount to work with. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to carefully tie that string very, very tightly at approximately that location, maybe about 3/4 of an inch from the end. And I'm going to tie it tight and a few times over. One of the issues that we have with using string is that students don't necessarily make a tight enough knot, and fluid can leak out when that happens. And we really want to make sure that fluid doesn't leak. So I'm going to tie it really tight, and I'm going to put another knot in there, and then I'm actually going to turn it over, wrap it around again, and put in an additional knot. Okay, so when you are finished, it should look something like this. Again, you can see where the knot is. Now we're going to go ahead and add our dialysis solution that has been dissolved into the dialysis tubing. Now, that tube is a little precarious. So what I recommend doing so that you don't knock it over, like I almost did a couple different times, is actually put it in the 50 milliliter beaker so that it gives it some stability, or a small cup so that you don't do that. So then go ahead and take your pipette and go ahead and transfer the solution over. It'll take you a little bit, but it's a nice clean way to transfer that solution into the dialysis tubing. Okay, you have transferred approximately 10 mils of solution into that dialysis tubing. And now what we're going to do is we are going to tie off the other end. Now, you'll want to tie off the other end like you did the first part. So in other words, you're going to do a pretty tight couple knots, but you want to tie it just above where the solution ends. So maybe a couple millimeters above where the solution ends, because if water comes in, you want to give the incoming fluid some room to expand. So you don't want to tie it too tightly. You want to make sure there's a little bit of play in that dialysis bag. You can kind of see where I'm tying it. It's just a little bit above where the solution ends. See, there's some air bubbles there. That's fine. Again, the important thing is that you make really, really tight knots. Once you've tied that second knot, go ahead and cut away some of the excess string, and you can even cut away some of the excess dialysis tubing so that your final bag looks like what I show here. Next, we need to determine the volume in the dialysis bag, but we don't have a scale, which is what we would typically use. Instead, we're going to make use of our graduated cylinder to measure the displacement as a way to determine volume. Consider this image. When we look at the meniscus, which is shown by the line, we see that the volume of fluid is 15 milliliters. So that is our initial volume. Now, let's say that I have some random bag that is who knows how much. We don't know what the volume is. Now, to determine the volume, I'm going to drop that oval bag of fluid into my cylinder, and it's going to displace the volume by a certain amount. Here you can see the volume was displaced up to 20 milliliters. So that's our final volume. Because we started with 15 milliliters and ended with 20 milliliters, the bag must have been the difference, or 5 milliliters. We're going to use that same approach here to measure the volume of the dialysis bag. Using the same approach, we are going to fill the graduated cylinder with exactly 50 milliliters of water. Now to do this, I use the 50 milliliter beaker and add water till I'm just past the 50 milliliter mark. So remember, you're going to use the meniscus, which actually dips down a little bit, to determine that 50 milliliter mark. To remove a little bit of the excess water so that I can get exactly 50 milliliters, I'm going to use my pipette. So now I'm at exactly 50 milliliters. I'm going to go ahead and take my dialysis bag and drop it in my graduated cylinder. And that is going to cause some displacement, and I will be able to measure the final volume. And from the difference between the final volume and the initial volume, I will be able to record the volume of my dialysis bag. You can let that dialysis bag sit in the graduated cylinder for about an hour and a half to allow dialysis to occur. Now, typically we would use a beaker, but it's really hard to get the dialysis bag out of the graduated cylinder once it's in. So just go ahead and leave it in the graduated cylinder to allow dialysis and osmosis to occur. Once the hour and a half are up, we are ready to resume our experiment. After your hour and a half incubation, it is time to analyze both the dialysis bag and the solution around the dialysis bag for evidence of diffusion and osmosis. I found that the easiest way to get the dialysis bag out and actually work with both solutions, both in and out of the bag, is to pour everything into a beaker as shown. Okay, once you do that, and you can go ahead and take a look at your dialysis bag, you can see here it looks a whole lot more turgid than it did when I at the start of the experiment, suggesting that maybe it gained some water. I'm going to put that aside, and what we're going to do is analyze the beaker solution. In our modified experiment, we are going to use urine multi-sticks to test for the presence of sugar and protein. So in your urine kit, you'll find some foil, and if you open that up, you'll see that you have some dipsticks. Now there are, I think, about 8 of them, but you'll only need 2 for this experiment. So go ahead and pull out 2 of them, and then make sure you seal that foil back up tightly and put it away somewhere where it's not exposed to light. Otherwise, they go bad. Okay, we're going to take 1 of those dipsticks, and we are going to go ahead and kind of dip it into the beaker so that every pad gets wet. And then we can go ahead and compare what we see on the dipstick with a color chart that is shown here. The urine dipsticks have 10 different things they assess for, but the only 2 that we care about right now are glucose, which is down at the very bottom, and proteins, which are 4th from the top. So after you wait 30 to 60 seconds, you can go ahead and compare the color on those pads, which are shown with the brown arrows, against the key, which is shown here. And this will allow you to determine if there is glucose and or protein in the solution that surrounded the dialysis bag. So this is known as the experimental beaker or experimental dish. Okay, we're almost done, but we have 2 more things to do. And the first thing that you need to do is measure the volume of fluid in the dialysis bag. So I suspected that it probably gained some water just based on how it felt, but now we're going to see if my prediction is true. We'll use the same technique as before, filling our graduated cylinder up to 50 milliliters and then measuring for the displacement, as we see here. So you'll want to do this with your dialysis bag. All right, our last step is just basically to confirm that there is in fact glucose and protein in our dialysis bag, so that we can get a positive control for what glucose and protein looks like on the dipstick. So I went ahead and just used scissors to kind of cut off the very top, get a little bit of an explosion there. So you might want to do it over your beaker. And then you're going to go ahead and take your dipstick and go ahead and dip it in the dialysis bag. Now it might be difficult to actually submerge all of the pads in the dialysis bag. So one thing that you can do is you can use your plastic pipette and just kind of squirt some of the solution over, or in my case, what I did is I just kind of dumped it over the multi-stick so that I covered all of the pads. But you could have also done something like this where you just kind of threw the solution on top of the multi-sticks. So once again, once you do that, then go ahead and rewind this video and look again at the key so that you can determine the presence of sugar and protein. All right, I hope you had a good time. None of this is going to be toxic waste, so you can go ahead and dispose of it down your drain. Thanks so much.